future, talk radio will actually educate, inspire, and make you think. The future is now. Topics and music that affect your life from Universal Broadcasting Network. Tune in at ubnradio.com. This is On Air with Tony Sweet, your number one source for all things entertainment, exclusive interviews and guests from TV, film, the Broadway stage, and your favorite musical artists of today. Talking shop is a given, but deep conversation is Tony's specialty. On Air with Tony Sweet starts now, exclusively on UBN Radio.
All right, everybody, it's On Air with Tony Sweet. I'm Tony Sweet right here on Universal Broadcasting Network. And Carla's not here this week. Well, she's going to be out for a little while, and we'll explain that when she gets back, because if I tell the wrong thing, she'll kick my butt. So, that said, we have sitting in today the one and only gorgeous from the show, the Marla and Dave Show, right here on Mondays at 6 p.m., Channel 1, Marla Thomas. Hi, Marla.
Can I ask you a question?
You
sure
can. It
just dawned on me that some kind of way I feel like I was running a race, and I've been given not the blue ribbon for winning, but runner up, because Carla Marla, I see what you tried to do.
I get it. Now I just
see
well,
what you tried
blonde.
To do.
I'm a little slow, so yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you're almost blonde.
The little Thanks.
Are you trying to look like me? Or?
I was hoping that when we go on tour,
we're going on tour
well,
together.
Well, yeah, here's the thing. Are. I don't want to be able to, it's embarrassing for me to talk about our upcoming tour when there are real artists
right.
in the room.
I want to go with you. Can I go with you on tour?
Well, no, because you can sing.
Yeah, we want people.
So, I don't have to sing. I can always yak.
Well, that's my job. Okay. And I just fake a singer on the tour.
Yeah. And tell the title of the tour.
Ebony and Ivory. But
I'm Ebony. She's Ivory.
Yes. And clearly I'm trying to, we're trying to mix it up.
That's good.
You know.
Meet somewhere in the middle.
Yeah. Right. Two blondies. I don't know.
I don't know. I like the reverse.
I'll try anything.
Well, my boobs are getting pretty big, so I can do the big blonde.
You need to control that. I'm the breast person. Oh. Get that under.
God.
Yeah, don't get jealous.
Check that.
Don't get jealous.
Check that.
Well, we thank everybody for joining us today, and today's show is brought to you by Earth Friendly Products, and for over 40 years, Earth Friendly Products have brought you the greenest home products for all your family needs. Go to ecos.com, that's ecos.com, and get all your products there.
Does that include marijuana? Because that's Earth Friendly. Not that I am a user, but my point is it's eco. Okay, forget
eco-friendly.
It.
Eco-friendly.
Yeah, that's what I've been told. It is just not the same thing if it grows from the earth. I'm like, yeah.
Well, you know, it's a seed-bearing plant.
Fertilizer can also be eco-friendly, too.
This is true. And also used with the seed-bearing plant. Thank
you. I love her. Well, we're not going to waste any time, because normally we wait till the 20 after and we just chit-chat. But we have like legends and divas that are in studio with us, and we can't waste time, okay? So we're going to have two lovely ladies, very talented. And I say they look like they're like 25 years old, and they keep telling me they've been doing this entertainment work for like 40-some years. I don't believe it.
Since the early 1800s.
I hate to say this, but to Tony Sweet's audience, just know that this is part of the option of the black package.
Thank you.
Right.
We get this. It happens.
Yeah. Black don't crack.
Right. I'm 100. I want to announce that.
Yes.
And it only tells the story when you actually have to see an x-ray of my innards. And you're like,
does it rub off? Because rub don't flub. I don't.
Rub don't flub. Okay.
I'm pretty sure that you can't get anti-aging through insemination. So it doesn't work out that way. I've never.
Well,
it's okay.
I was going to say.
Yeah. See,
I'm going to have to go to church after this one.
Okay. We can have service right here.
Right. Yes. All right. So we're going to introduce our guest. We have this lovely lady to our my left, maybe your right on the screen. She's been working in this industry for so long as an actress, singer. And I'm just going to hold this up. This is her bio. Her bio is like 24 pages long.
Can you extend the show today so we can accommodate all of her accomplishments?
Thank you.
She's worked with Barry Manilow, Bette Midler, who I love both, very talented. And she's been blessed to work with Chaka Khan, Luther Vandross, Lainey Kazan, really, good job. I love her. Muddy Waters, Sisters Love. I mean, the list goes on and on and on. And also, she was part of the group, the formerly of the Harlettes.
That's right.
And we're going to be playing some music for her, but we have... Charlo Cross. I was going to call you Charlo, but it's not.
It's Charlo.
It's Charlo.
Charlo. It's actually Charlotte. Actually, the royal baby was named after me.
Oh!
Thank you.
I love it. You see there?
Oh.
Yes, that's right.
Well.
She put her stamp as diva in the royals.
That's a diva in the royals. Thank you.
You did.
I'll take that. I'll take that.
It'd be funny if she turns out to be like this amazing singer.
Honey, she should.
She should, with that name. Yeah. And so we have next to her... one of the last Supremes.
No.
Weren't you one of the last? The last Supremes. You were the last member to be signed on.
We're going to pull your mic
up just a little bit.
Because I know they want to hear everything that you're saying.
All right.
I'm just so excited to have her and Charlotte on because this... Anyway, I'm going to get back to
her. Let me explain something.
You explain it because...
Let me just help. I understand, but what this is really going to be, we're in the presence of divas, so you can actually, for the first time, walk out with a diva glow. That's why I came, because no one gives me any credit for being a diva. Matter of fact, my family doesn't even listen to me. I don't even know that they even know that I left home right now. Well, but when I come back,
I know what that's like.
When I come back, oh, they're going to know I'm there.
That's come right. That's
you
right.
got to let them know. Mm-hmm.
Right. You see what they had? Oh, they're going to know when I get back.
Exactly.
It's going to happen.
Diva.
But you're also a songwriter, too. You wrote for Denise Williams, who I love Denise Williams. I really, really do. And you've worked with amazing artists. See, you paired with Michael Jackson's hit album, right?
Yes, I wrote I Can't Help It from his Off the Wall album with Stevie Wonder. And we're celebrating the 35th year of I Can't Help It and of Off the Wall. And I just have done a DVD that's going to be Spike Lee's new documentary about Off the Wall.
Wait a minute, I got to do that.
Can we
pause the list of credits for a minute? Because I have to jump in and ask you.
All right.
First of all, that's epic.
Yes, it is.
That's legendary music.
Yes.
Forever. Mm-hmm. What was the inspiration? What inspired you to write? I mean, come on.
Well, I hadn't been in Wonder Love very long with Stevie Wonder. I was singing. I was given a solo spot in his show. And we went on the road and we started writing almost immediately together. You meet writers, but every once in a while there's something special there. He would hum a melody and, you know, it just mumble his way through it. And for some reason, I know what he's talking about, you know, and that's just a magical thing that happens every once in a while. So Steve, of course, you know, is all about, if you listen to his music, you know, it's all about uplifting and love. And you know, you think he's probably always in love. But at this particular moment in time, we had started writing. We realized that it clicked. You know, we could write things that really had a flow to them and a magic to them. And actually, I can't tell the story of how it got from us to Michael because that's the part that is.
I just wanted to know what inspired the actual lyrics to
love,
I Can't. Okay.
Love. Okay. See, Steve, I believe, Stevie Wonder, I believe, writes from so many things, exciting things that happen around him in his life.
Mm-hmm.
And he taught me that you can do that. Songs are not always autobiographical. Mm-hmm. They're not things necessarily that have happened to you. But what they can be is situations that you might be in or situations that happen. You know, we all see if we're grown, we see all kinds of stuff, especially on the road.
Okay.
You know, you see
right.
all kinds
I'm sure.
of things around the world. And it's one of the things that makes us all one, really, is that. You know, music, it doesn't matter what the language is.
Amen
right, it's universal.
Doesn't it? It's what you feel. So we were inspired by a moment. You know, we'd be in the studio. He's in the studio 24-7.
Right.
He'd call you at 6 o'clock in the morning and say, come
well,
yeah, in
Yeah, because he can't. I've experienced that,
sure.
actually. I actually hung up on Stevie Wonder, if you want to know my story.
All right, good for you.
Because he was calling to speak to my husband, and he said, hello, this is Steven. And we lived in Nashville at the time. I'm like, yeah, okay, click. It's 4 o'clock in the morning.
And how many Stevelands do you know in this life?
I didn't even know his name was Stevelands.
See, that's what I'm talking.
That was in the early days of Take Six. Before I'm telling you, when I tell you I'm a midwife, you don't get it.
I like the show. I like the show. Right. Call the midwife.
There it is. So yeah. So I do know that, you know, and I you know, because we would call him friend as well. I'm pretty sure it's because he just can't tell the difference between night and day.
But I don't know.
I volunteered.
He's got that 24-hour cycle going. Sure.
I have volunteered to work with him on that if he would like to. Okay. Anyway.
Well, we didn't get to actually give her this. Suzy Grain is in the house. Oh! Yes.
Hello. Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Well, you know, what is it like when you hear people call you like divas? Because people can take it both ways. Like a diva is like, wow, you've made an impact on music industry, or a diva like, oh,
hard to work
she's
with.
A diva.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, I think that traditionally the diva term was developed referring to specifically opera singers.
Operatic divas.
Operatic divas who, you know, the sopranos, the contraltos, you know. I think that it goes to it spills over into the fact that this was a time when these particular singers were being nurtured. They were just just in a world, a bubble of their own. And so when they were outside of that very controlled bubble of maestros and and what have you, they didn't know how to behave. And their demands were so great that an ordinary person, it's kind of unreasonable. But there are people who do function in that area. I'm not one of them. But
can you name
not
names?
Me.
I'm just kidding.
Well, I would, but what's left of my career is so important right now that I hold on to that. I think diva now is in a fun way. I'd like to refer to it in a fun way, because it's someone who's very inclusive of everyone in the room, and they're grateful, and they're gracious, and they're not demanding that, you know, all white flowers in their room at
white
carpeting.
There are those.
Or that you pick up. Go ahead.
I'm just going to say there are those ladies who, shall we say, have desires for their own world.
Yes, always.
They are queen. Yes.
And those I've heard, there are those who have a special person picking out only the purple marshmallows in the Lucky Charms. Mm-hmm. That would be the younger generation.
Okay,
of diva.
You know,
see, I just
not
find
necessarily.
That funny.
That's a whole lot to me. You know, but the white flower, having to have white flowers and white things, and then there's some people who have to have specific water always. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to mention her names, but she's married to a very famous actor.
Yes.
Well, see, Kurt, you know, the employee here, I only make him pick out the certain colors just because I think it's funny.
That's
not that
that's
you're trying to sign on to being a diva.
That's different.
But do you think that divas, and to piggyback on what Tony's saying, with the new generation of women in music, the younger generation, do you think the term is watered down? Like I don't think it's watered down at all. But and do can we use it though? With because it became weaker to me when I looked from the musicians and even the presentation of women in music from the past. You know, Diana Ross. I mean, the list goes on. I mean,
funny
just
you should
bring her up.
I think that's where the perception of diva as the sort of, please forgive the term, bitch goddess, you know, it was encapsulated by the big hair and the
I was going to say it was her weave. That's what happened.
And all of that, you know.
But that was detachable.
Yes. Also.
Don't sneeze hard.
Whoa.
Also, it made a tremendous effect, I think, on the culture.
Yes.
You know,
I agree.
Young women nowadays, at a certain point, it became a not nice term.
But what I'm also saying, it should be. I always felt like that word diva shouldn't even be attached until you've earned it, which is kind of what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, even if you have a mini phenomenal career, it's not really a career yet, in my book. When you have a couple of hits or whatever the case is, or you've been seen on 3 award shows, and then all of a sudden you're calling all the shots, you don't get white flowers. Stop asking. You don't get white flowers.
You know,
yeah.
I mean, I'm annoyed by it.
How about just the ones from Ralph's?
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. The $4.99.
Exactly. Yeah. They've been marked down to $1.99. But you brought up a very, very interesting point about earning it, because I think that it's so much more about the creative achievement, and I'm talking about real artistic
right.
achievement yes. and continuing of that quality and that excellence that encourages people to be excellent.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And you've got a lot of mediocrity out here. You've got a lot of people who are given the moniker of diva, mm-hmm. and they're just... they're not even in the room.
Mm. You're already you're in the realm of mediocrity when you're covering someone else's songs.
I mean, not necessarily.
You're talking about bad cover.
I'm talking about auto-tune. Right. I'm talking about things that aren't original. Right. And when I say I don't mean writing and
no
what you're saying.
Thank you.
I'm talking about the sound.
The sound
is so
exactly.
canned.
Yes.
We've lost real music.
Well, I think that the real music is still in existence. I think that you've got talent that is not trained, mm-hmm. and they're not just untrained musically. They are untrained about how to be with people, how to be gracious, how to be have home training.
Absolutely.
They're missing a lot of key elements of character that, you know, unfortunately gets developed in the, you know, on YouTube or gets mm-hmm. developed on Facebook or Twitter or these other, you know, social media. And that's not the place for people to necessarily grow up because it's not to be trained.
Sure.
I mean, you know, it's like when I think about what Suze experienced as a Supreme and the intense training and inundation of how to stand. When I watch her and Sherry Payne, when I watch their show, I see all of that training mm-hmm. because of the way they stand, right. because of the way they're presented, because just everything, it's so precise, but they were trained.
Mm-hmm. Right.
They were trained. It was beaten into me. But that's another story. But the point of it is that kind of expertise, that kind of excellence, that kind of training and just entertainment.
Well, that was
thing.
That was right. That's back in the day where you
they
would
have to
actually,
get back to that.
Right. Well, now it's not. Now that's the training for excellence in music is different than trying to become famous. Or infamous for foolishness.
Mm-hmm. Ooh,
that's
a good preach.
That's
a good preach.
Subject.
That's a really
good
and I'm a big subject.
That's huge. And we talk about it a lot.
It's also a big concern, I think, for entertainers who look and try to raise the bar and try to make a legacy, you know, to see, well, where is it going to lead us? What is the example that's being given now?
Mm-hmm.
You know, if there is an example that you can show up with your everything out, and that's what makes you infamous, and it has nothing to do with talent, has nothing to do with training, or even passion, you know, dedication to what you're doing. But when you come from, you know, I come from a long line of entertainers. My mother was a coach for me, for other people. She got Janet Jackson ready to go into the recording industry, Cheryl Lynn, a lot of artists, a lot of young artists. Webster, you remember Webster, the little boy, she trained him. And the training that goes,
Emmanuel Lewis.
There is no school for that now. There is no training ground. There's not even in schools, there's not a music program.
There's no desire, the talent. There's no art.
Right. There's no way to inspire young people except for people who have that in their mind to go out of their way to create those situations for young people. You know?
And what I want to do is we're going to take a quick music break from these lovely ladies. But schooling, this show alone is such a great opportunity for young artists to listen to people that have been there, done that, and still doing it.
Sure.
Because so many people have been there, done that, and stopped doing it
because
they can't make it the longevity in this music industry.
That's right, but that's a very important point.
Very important point because I know people that come to this city of L.A., and I'm sure many different cities, they come here looking for that dream. They give up so easy because they think it's going to be easy because they see all the reality shows now. But first of all, I'm gonna play something from Suze. Suze, we have a couple songs here, and I'd like you to choose which one you'd like us to play.
All right.
What do you feel like playing, and then you can explain what this song is about. We have Living in a Vacuum, Love Controls You, Black and Blue, and then High Energy.
Well, if we would play Black and Blue. Black and Blue is the opening for an album that I did called Brave New Shoes. And Brave New Shoes I produced. I wrote most of the song. I did some covers. And covers, by the way, I think are a way for you to do something that's familiar right. to people. Mm-hmm. But it's about doing it your own way. And making a stamp, you know, who can come in and sing Respect after Aretha? Right. You know what I'm saying?
Right. That's true.
That's the point of a cover to me. Mm-hmm. You have to make it your own.
Yeah.
I would appreciate it if you'd play Black and Blue because it's a tiny little thing, but it kind of introduces.
And right? then when we finish up with that one, I'm going to play Swing.
Oh, good.
Because I want to play them back to back because, again, I want to show people what true artistry is all about.
There's no
auto-tune. It's about vocals. It's yes. about the musicians behind sure. the vocals and how it intertwines and not just somebody creating it in a control room
yes. sure.
or editing room. So
and not to mention the fact that we have visual.
And visual, yes.
And they're not naked. So we would right. like to
I'm
say,
not, and right. I don't want
to
be.
Something that's, we need to right. talk about, too.
But when we come
thank
back.
Thank you, ladies, for being dressed.
Oh, right. Thank you.
But when always, we come back, covered. We're going to talk about your new music.
Fine.
Again, we're talking longevity, so we're going to sure. talk about new music. So,
thank you.
On Air with Tony Sweet with Marla Thomas, yeah, Suze Green,
hello.
And Charlo Crosley. So that's don't go
me.
Anywhere. Be right back.
Time's thoughts embrace my heart. Every time Suze says, timeless love surround us all. Ladies and gentlemen, Suze.
Red, yellow, green, and purple, the baby blue.
These are the colors of my soul.
Silver, pink, and chartreuse, black and blue.
crowd goes wild.
Thank you. That's what it's all about. Can I tell you something right quick, ladies? Just if you just give me one quick second with Tony, we're not going on tour.
No.
See what I'm saying?
No.
The work, we have not done enough work.
Yeah. I thought we were ready, but after hearing that, no.
Clearly, just our blonde hair is not going to be enough for us to succeed at what we think we want to do. Fantastic.
Yeah. Amazing.
That is, I mean, and like Tony said, you know, it kind of gives you chills when you think of the depth and the way that you present music and song. It's even if it almost feels like if you didn't have a lyric, it tells a story. Like, it draws you into a different story. Like, in other words, listening, if I close my eyes, I could literally go into a mood based on both songs.
Well, that's what Thank we hope you. To yeah. do, you yeah. know.
Well, okay, it kicks. I've been in the same mood, though, listening to pop music these days. That's what I'm trying to tell you. Not a lot has changed for me, but thanks a lot for bringing back the reality.
You mentioned the nudity. I was watching the Met Gala just recently.
Oh, here
and
we go.
What a kick in the head that Rihanna had on more clothes than everyone.
Well, because Beyonce had already planned to be naked. They can't be naked together.
This is true.
Did you see the same night as the Met was an award show for a porn industry?
No.
So they showed a picture of the Met, and they showed a picture of the porn. The porn was actually all sophisticated. They dressed in fully dressed.
Because they're always naked. That was new for them.
I know, right? But I just thought that was so funny to see the difference of the two.
Well, you know,
it's changed.
To mention that and artistry and what I call, you know, the flash of media
overkill.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, even when I say media, the word that I'm really looking for is shock. Mm-hmm. Because, for example, I personally happen to think, and you ladies are in the industry, so your careers will be affected. So I might be saying everything that might be in your mind, but I can say it because I'm just a jazz midwife. Mm-hmm. So here's the deal. Lady Gaga goes on my list of people that I'd like to slap. And the reason is because she's talented.
Oh, she's an amazing singer.
But I was so disgusted for so long with meat dresses and being born out of an egg. Mm-hmm. And it almost took away from the fact that she really, like the stuff she's doing now with Tony Bennett, she can sing.
She basically is
a true talent.
She really is.
But to me, she hid her talent and gimmick when she didn't need to. That's what was upsetting me. It was like, what are you doing?
She studied fine arts in addition to all of her classically trained music and voice education. But so she's had a fine arts education as a painter, as a visual artist. And I think that so many people can love to hide behind that kind of thing with her. But I think she really proved her mettle as when she got up there and was with Tony Bennett, because he's no joke. And she brought it. I was so happy because so many of the songs that she sang are songs that I've been listening to and been doing my own homework. You know, this is the kind of stuff that a lot of singers, we listen to the old singers and we are just woodshedding and listening to the tone and to the enunciation and to telling the story.
And
because they've got such great lyrics and great composers that they're drawing from. But, you know, she brought it. My hat's off to her.
That's my point, though.
Yeah.
She can bring it.
Yeah.
That is my point. Yeah. To me, she could. She always musically in her class, and I say it's almost like a freshman class.
Yes.
To me, she stood out from day one.
Yeah.
As far as being a true artist and again, I can say what I want. The Britney Spears thing to me was like, what? Okay, so just as far as it, gimmicks would make sense. I mean, you know, to do certain things, because those two are nowhere near in the same ball game.
Not at all.
And she may be a good performer, I mean, as far as entertaining you, but Gaga has a different ability.
And comes from a different discipline.
Right.
When you look at Brit, you look at Christina Aguilera and Justin and all of them, they all came out of that Disney camp.
Right.
And that's kind of like a sponge sugar kind of a world. But they were intensely trained.
Yes. But I have to say that Justin
is brilliant.
And Christina are both real artists.
They're real artists.
It's the same thing as when Lady Gaga jumps out there and uses what there is to use. You know, she had a contract with Michael Jackson's publishing company. She really made her first money as a music songwriter and publisher. Right. Mm-hmm. And when she jumped out there, she knew that she had to do something that was uniquely different in order to get the attention. Because there are no Barbara Streisands jumping out there. Okay, she could have done that had she come up at the same time as Barbara Streisand. But nowadays, you know, she is a modern young woman who deals with Twitter. She was one of the first people to follow me back on Twitter.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
You what's, know, your Twitter, what's your Twitter handle, Susay?
Susay, S-U-S-A-Y-E.
I'm right all there. Over that.
Hey.
Right below us, right there.
I'm all over it. I'm going to get that.
You can find me lots of places. Twitter. I'm on Facebook. Twitter.
Mama Charlo.
Twitter is a PR.
I do have a Twitter page.
Yes. But you must use it more.
All right, I will. Thank you.
I said,
the thing is about
Marla,
Twitter.
It's Mama Charlo.
Mama Charlo. That's true.
Twitter was presented.
I can't just. Oh, no. That means that there's room in her home for me.
I need to move into your house.
No, you don't want that. You got the 5-year-old grandson, you know, from time to time, all
that's
over
okay.
the kids.
I've got a 21-year-old and a husband.
Come on,
they have their own rooms. Thank God, hallelujah.
21 and a husband. Okay,
sure.
Right. Yeah. So you've got two children too, then possibly.
Yes. and my son's band. And my son's band.
Is he band?
They come over and they rehearse. I stop rehearsing at home. So they rehearse at home now.
Yes, indeed.
Well,
yes.
Time is going so fast.
I'm so sorry.
I just want to make sure we talk about the new music.
Okay, yes.
So, Charlotte, I want to bring this up here. Live at the Gardenia.
Yes, sir.
So tell us about the music. Tell us about what inspired you to create this.
Well, you know, once again, these are songs that I had been listening to, primarily Nancy Wilson and Ella Fitzgerald. And I just said, I want to sing these songs. This is what I want to do. I want to get up there and look cute and sing well and have, you know, piano and stand-up bass, maybe drums sometimes. Mm-hmm. And I just want to get out there because I've been singing background for so long. I really didn't have and been in trios. I didn't have any identity that I wanted to bring out there. So this was my step out. So I'm working on some other stuff, and I'm just singing the songs that I like. Thank you so much.
Well,
but it was about, you know, and just raw vocals. I was encouraged by Ella Fitzgerald did a thing called 12 Nights in Hollywood. That is, if you haven't heard it, Miss Woman, that's what you need to be playing.
12
up
Nights in Hollywood?
12 Nights in Hollywood. You need to be playing that up in your house. It'll change the situation up in there.
All right.
Now.
But I was encouraged by that.
Will I come out of therapy if I play that instead?
It'll help.
Okay.
Because it helps me.
All right. I'm all over it.
But it was important to sing the songs that I wanted to sing.
Of course, yeah.
And exercise my vocal power and just discovery, you know, at this wonderful time of life, just discovering something new about me that I can do. And there's nobody to tell me no. And I just felt just really free to.
Not a great.
Well, Charlotte, I have
feeling.
A quick question for you just about
yes, ma'am.
That, for both you and Susay.
Yes.
Is there a genre that is really that something that would take you over the brink that you have not explored yet musically that you think you'd want to?
I wouldn't say that there's something I haven't explored as yet.
Okay.
Because I'm all about multi-genres.
Okay.
I don't believe in being channeled or perceived as doing one thing. I was classically trained, so I'm going to do some of that again. That's some of the recording that I've been doing. I'm doing jazz material. I've been recording over the past couple of years.
Okay.
Done a lot of things in a lot of different genres. A lot of the standards that I grew up singing that were, you know, growing up in New York, you're exposed, particularly when I came up, because there was Barbara Streisand.
Right.
You know, so you had those songs from the influence of Broadway and other shows. And that's what you did. And then, of course, because I'm a big pop head, you know, I love pop music. I'll always sing and perform and write pop music and R&B or whatever you want to call it. But I've worked with a lot of hip-hop artists, a lot of samples. A lot of people sample my music. Mm-hmm. And they've been nothing but kind, nothing but generous. It pays really well, so I get to stay home.
And, I hear you.
You know what I'm saying.
I do.
You do what is. That's the thing about the modern times. The things I've learned as an independent artist is you do the kind of music that you love, which is what I love hearing Charlo say, particularly at this time in our lives. You know, I know what I want to do. Mm. And consequently, that's
and this is what you're doing as a teenager. Just wait till you get older.
Sure. There you go. But, you know, there's technology. The thing about Twitter, the reason I insist that you become more active on Twitter, Twitter was presented from a PR perspective.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It's called social media marketing. And classic artists need to understand that. It's 140 characters, 140 spaces. It teaches you to be concise, teaches you to really to market to your audience.
Right.
Mm-hmm. They come to you if you say the right things. I am involved in so many different things. Peace Prize, peaceprize.com. Please check peaceprize.com out. That is something that is being formed right now. There's a network that's going to be involved. There's a foundation that's going to be involved. We're going to present to the world because we're dealing with big issues like water, like health, like educating children, re-educating women. Part of my focus has got to be women's issues because if you are going to bet on the future, then women are the best bet.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they are the nurturers in spite of working in the workplace, in spite of doing, and I'm, you know, dream big. Please, ladies, dream big. Please, girls, dream big. Because if you're dreaming, for heaven's sake, why not dream the biggest, the most?
I love it.
We're working on self-esteem because that's a tremendous problem for girls particularly and boys as well. So many of the things that happen to young people nowadays, it's because they have low self-esteem.
Mm-hmm.
We want young women to be educated, to be strong, to be healthy, to understand that their worth is what makes them be able to do whatever it is they dream and to accomplish that. So we're going to do those things. We're going to do a lot of tremendous shows for everyone. Charlo and I are going to be doing some shows together for Peace Prize.
Nice.
Yes, and for a lot of other situations. So there's a lot. You know, I don't believe in anyone. If you have talent, if you have passion, I don't believe that you can't accomplish what you set out to do, because with the technologies that's there, you've got Twitter, you've got Facebook, you've got WordPress, you've got MySpace still, you've got Pinterest,
is
you've
MySpace
got Instagram.
Still?
It's still, not only is it still, MySpace is a place that you can still present your music.
It's
really all about
Justin
music.
Justin Timberlake invested into that.
Indeed. Except, you know, smart move.
Yeah.
Just watch and see.
You know, Suze, you brought up such great points in terms of your passion to help young women. And one of the things that I've been doing in my master's classes that I've done in the past is to help train up young people who want to be in entertainment. Mm-hmm. But it's not just the training, it's the personal motivation, the personal, you know, you've got a lot of kids out here who just, they just think that this is like spaghetti. You can throw it up against the wall and see if it sticks.
Right.
And it's not like that, because it requires their personal spiritual connection to what they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, being a person of faith, it's something that I've taken very seriously, because when I came into faith, all of my career changed. Everything changed, and it became, I was more present, and that was that was a very, very important thing. And so many people are not present, and they're just the walking wounded. They're like zombies. Mm. They're walking through this
darkness.
This darkness within our industry, and this is the thing that's trumped up, and this is the thing that's promoted, and this is not there's got to be somebody saying, hello, you can take another,
right?
You can
there's
take
something
another
else.
You can take another pathway that helps you nurture you, take care of you, and not have you, because I went through that. I mean, you know, and I didn't have anybody to tell me to somebody to really pull my coat, because I was just out there in the industry. I didn't have the kind of family support that I needed, because back when I started, when like Suze and I started in this business, she was blessed that she had a mother that was there for her. But when you don't have anybody being there for you, and they tell you that you need to go work at the post office, and you know that you are not post office material. And my daddy worked at the post office for 25 years, so I'm not against that. But just knowing, you know, it's like...
In your soul, you knew who you were. That wasn't the fit.
I knew how I was, and it was not popular to declare that you knew that you were supposed to do something else. It was just not... It was just so verboten. And just pushing past that. So that was a big character builder for me, but I was completely out of my mind and I needed help and I got some help. I got some good psychological and good psychiatric help. And so I feel like, and I'm a great proponent of getting help. It's like, you don't have to stay sick. You don't have to stay crazy. You don't have to be jacked up. And particularly if you're an artist, that doesn't have to necessarily be your motivation for your creative. That's not who, that doesn't have to mark you.
Right.
You know, some people, they get a real high off of that, you know, and it's like, okay, that's boring to me because after you get some medicine, then you get stable, then what? Nobody wants to talk to you because you're completely boring.
Right.
How do you maintain your, how do you maintain your personality, the essence of who you are, who, you know, the positive thing that's being put out there.
And I think one thing that I really enjoyed was 20 Feet from Stardom.
Oh,
because I think this is kind of what you're talking about, that there's so many people out there that are, they're not always at the forefront. But doesn't mean they're any less of a talented.
That's very true.
And so talk to us a little bit about 20 Feet from Stardom and it, Oscar winning, which it was well deserved.
Grammy too.
So talk about how important it is for people really to understand what somebody that sings behind very talented people, but sometimes those people behind are the most talented.
I'd just like to say that the term 20 feet from stardom, you know, I think that the reason that it reached so many people's hearts and spirits was because you're always supporter. You know, it doesn't matter what, whether you're in show business or whatever, whatever the subject is, whatever the job is, everybody needs that team of people who are the foundation. Somebody's in the background, somebody's in the in the front, but that's what makes it happen.
Right.
You know, when I was approached about 20 feet, I had tremendous doubts because I'm like, really, you know, I don't know if a movie about, you know, background singers is what people want to hear. But it wasn't really about background singers.
Yeah, right.
It was about hope.
Right.
You know, it was about knowing that you have talent and someone giving you inspiration, even if that inspiration is a song for you to make up the backgrounds and sing and support that. You know, and how many songs do we know about that the backgrounds made that song, you know? I mean, I think that the people that were chosen to be in 20 Feet, it was a moment in time that needed to inspire a lot of other people. It's really
and
about
it did. And I think it goes way beyond just the talent of singers. It goes to other industries, and entertainment, and just, you know, everyday people that, you know, the boss and the president and the CEO, but the ones underneath are the ones that are the foundation that really
the
run the company.
People.
Yeah.
Well, you know, when this is the thing that was so interesting about 20 Feet, I didn't know Suse personally before this movie. And it was incredible because so many of us who had been doing the grunt work behind big stars, when we all came together, we realized that our story was unique in some areas, but not so unique in others. But we were a part of a sisterhood, and there were so many things required of us. And I think just being able to work with someone like a Ray Charles, work with someone like a Bette Midler, you've got to have confidence.
Right.
I mean, and we started out, we were just young whippersnappers. And I had come out of a Broadway background, so I had, you know, I was just like one of those Broadway Coreens out of a 1920 movie. They just keep going from one show to the next, one after the other, and they're tough. It's like, okay, they're not little wallflowers. They're tough, so it's like, okay, I'm singing with Bette Midler. This is someone who was my friend, but now I'm in the, you know, we're I would go over to her house, and she would have trunks and trunks of music. And so we'd be going through old sheet music, wow. And she'd have some guy just sitting there, and he'd just be playing them out. And she'd go, well, how do you like that? I don't know. We'd throw that one out.
Wow.
But so that's the kind of—
That's a dream right there.
Just that kind of working together and, right. And getting in the trenches, that kind of stuff. You have to have, you can't be a wallflower. You got to be tough. You got to get in there. And and in order to remain for a period of time. Mm-hmm.
Longevity.
Longevity. But once again, having the training to be in the room. And it's not something that I take for granted. It's something that, when I look back, I was like real kind of like, oh, yeah, okay. But that was just what you did to get to keep going. And when you talk about this kind of stuff to these young kids now, it overwhelms them. Mm. But it can be a lot of fun, and it definitely— Honey, you find out where you're located.
Listening to the two of them talk is very interesting because my brain is deep in the actual concept of everything that you're saying, because I too am into empowering, especially young women, and the self-esteem thing. But what's interesting about what you guys are talking about with this particular movie, you mentioned being a support. Mm-hmm. And that's deep, because what you're saying, it that thread goes through everything in life.
Absolutely.
It's the same thing. You know, I've raised three kids. You know, my husband has 10 Grammys, but technically, no, I'm serious. But he does, because, you know, I was a fearless nurturer, meaning it wasn't— these were the roles that we took on. And that sometimes is a harder thing behind the scenes to do. Than the person who you see, you know, who's out front, and fortunately and unfortunately, you know, it deserves to be recognized. But at the same time, it's very interesting, because this perception that people put on what they see, not understanding what the pillars are that allow them to be elevated.
Come on. That's right.
I'm constantly trying to break that down.
Sure. It's very true. Not only, I mean, if you just consider from the aspect of it's not your dream.
Yeah.
Right.
You understand? As the support, as the wife, you're living this person's dream. You didn't ask to be famous. You didn't ask for people to come up and be all in your business. You didn't, you know, fame is a monster.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It is. Nobody teaches these kids to be famous.
I.e. the young man who just left
One Direction.
Sure. One Direction, because he said I wasn't ready, and one of the most transparent conversations that I've ever had, honestly, was with Brian Littrell from the Backstreet Boys. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And Dave was working with the guys, and he sat down, we all hit it off, and he said, "You know what, man? I sang in my church and I loved to sing. I had no idea that I would become a prisoner to this machine called fame." Sure. He wanted to sing. Now he has to he was dressing up in a wig to go to the movies with his wife, and has to have a separate location to have things delivered, so you can't ever really get to us. I mean, he literally, and that's not in his life. That is not what he signed up for.
Wow. Who does?
So what? Right. So right. So but well, some people now people think, you know, I'm gonna throw a name, Kardashian, whatever. The bottom line is, it does happen where it's not you actually are fame seeking. Mm-hmm. You want that. Mm-hmm. But for a lot of people who are talented artists, their love was for the artistry of what they did and the appreciation.
Right. Well, it's called show business.
Right.
And nobody tells you how difficult, how much dedication, how much time, how much effort.
Right.
You know, they just see the red carpet, or they see... Mm-hmm. You know, you see you on TV or whatever, but no one tells you what a solitary existence, how strong you have to be, how you have to really not give a damn what people
period.
Think, Absolutely. How you
period,
have to create for yourself,
Absolutely.
To grow yourself, your spirit. The music is for your healing.
Yes.
It's about that. It has very little to do with y'all. Now, you know what I'm saying? It really doesn't.
You know, it's very interesting, because when you're in the studio, and even if it's somebody else's song that you're singing, or whatever it is, but you've got something invested in it emotionally. And so when you're in the studio and you're standing behind the mic, and there's something about this song that's that you're invested in and you're bringing it across. Nobody can take that away from
right.
you. Nobody can, people can interject and go back to this and do this right. and do this. But it's such a solitary place, and I find it a very peaceful place, and it's a place that needs to be protected and cared for. I've really come to appreciate that.
Sure.
But I just wanted to work. I didn't, I would have enjoyed having some of that kind of fame, but because I was watching other people blow up.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, when you're working with someone like a Bette Midler and you're playing colleges, and, you know, we go out on a Thursday and come back on a Sunday, and you're like in Ithaca, New York,
right.
you know, and it's snowing, and you're walking to an auditorium that's packed to the rafters, people smoking pot, and the minute the downbeat, the music happens, you know, it's just, it's on, it's crazy, it's raw, you know, that was so exciting, but it was a big shock for me because I had been doing Broadway. So coming out of a very disciplined,
right.
you know, 2.5 hour show, you know, you get there at half hour and you know, it was a very strict discipline. But I say all that to say that you got to take care of that thing that's so precious to you.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you're somebody's support and you're watching somebody just blow up, it's interesting because then you find that the person that you knew who was your friend, it changes them.
It really does.
They don't.
It can.
Family. Family yeah. changes. Yeah.
Yeah. It can. Yeah. Unless you're Marla and you keep a nice long needle and you keep deflating air systematically every 2 weeks.
That's
air deflate. Flat. Oh.
Well,
yeah,
ladies,
but you know, you're the one that builds up too. You know, you may deflate, but you're building up in ways that people don't see, and that's
right.
that's what. That
well, they
matters.
See most everything because when I'm beating him on the tennis court, and things,
right.
so I'm posting it.
Well, ladies, I can't believe their time
Are
is
you
up.
Kidding me?
No.
I know.
Me,
I know.
Me.
It went so fast.
Oh, wow. So is it 20 feet from stardom?
Yeah. 20 feet from
20
stardom.
20 feet from stardom. Mm-hmm. And also, we're going to. Where can you get your CD, Charlo?
You can still get it on CD Baby and on Amazon. It's Charlo Crossley live at the Gardenia. Mm-hmm.
And I know you can get majority of your music and both your music
sure.
on iTunes, I'm sure.
Sure, iTunes, Amazon. You know, every major. I have my own record company. So,
oh, nice.
You know, so I distribute
everything. Look at her.
Dollface music.
See, this is when Diva becomes functional.
Right.
This is what we love
that's
about
what,
this. Yeah, this is functional Diva.
That's what longevity is all about.
Yeah, this
right.
is when Diva matters.
Exactly.
You know? Can I be on your label? Can
well,
I be on
label?
Oh, we must talk about
can
that.
You?
I told you we haven't talked.
Yes, true.
And while
probably. You're committing to that, thank you, ladies, as well. Before you go, I have to say thank you for giving Tony and I the title to our tour.
Yes.
We're not 20 feet, dude. Like 50. We're 50 feet.
50.
We're
1,500.
50.
We're still out
don't
front
listen, you
trying to get in.
Don't put me in the boonies. 50 feet.
But,
50 feet. I
but,
like that.
We want to thank you ladies so much for
Thanks
being
for
here.
Thank you.
Suzanne Green, and then we have
Charlo Crossley.
Crossley. And so, but I want, before you go, will you please, one of our UBN hosts, Damona Hoffman, is on the phone. And but she has a project that's coming. I think is it a TV show that you have coming up tomorrow there, Damona?
It's a webinar, my friend.
Webinar, that's
Hello.
Right. Well, it was more something
free
like that.
Webinar. Yeah.
So
I'm
so
going
tell us
back
about
to
it
my roots.
Because all tell right. us all about it because some of us might need your help.
Well, I mean, clearly the ladies, your esteemed guests, do not need my help. But for any listeners who are actors out there, I used to be a casting director, and I used to teach classes for actors in auditioning and marketing because I found they're really talented actors that just didn't know what to do to get their foot in the door, and then they didn't know once they got their foot in the door what to do to stay there to get called back again.
I
so
need your help.
So I started teaching these classes in just that skill. So I partnered up with my former boss from CBS Paramount.
Well,
her name is
me.
Sheila
All
Guthrie,
right,
yeah. and she's an amazing casting director. She's had, she might slap me for saying this, but she's been casting for about 30 years and
wow.
has had okay. great shows on her resume from Cheers to Frasier to Wings, Becker.
Fantastic.
Anyhow, we really want to just give back and give information to actors about what's really happening behind the scenes. So it's called Hollywood Town Hall at hollywoodtownhall.com. And the topic is authentic auditioning, straight talk on how to get the role you want.
I wow. need your help.
Well, seeing your resume,
how to get the role
I
want.
Oh, one you want. Okay.
Mama Charlo needs to put you to work, honey. Thanks for calling us.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Damone. I'm so glad. Hopefully everybody will fill up the room tomorrow.
See everybody on HollywoodTownHall.com tomorrow at 1.
Tomorrow at 1, everybody.
Perfect.
Go learn something.
Thank you.
All right.
Thanks, Tony. Thanks, ladies.
Thank you.
All right. Well, on our way out, we're going to play some more music. And I think, what do you want to play, Miss Suzanne?
High Energy.
High Energy. That sounds like a good one. And then we'll finish up one right after that. And I think, which one would you like? Does Your Mama Know About Me?
Because
I love that. I just like the title.
So what's the title? Does Your Mama Know What?
Does Your Mama Know About Me?
You know who wrote that? Tommy Chong.
Tommy Chong, really?
Zedong Chong's dad.
Oh, I was going to say, you're doing it again. You forgot I was a midwife. I'm like, Tommy Chong. If you see my face go blank with the stare, just imagine that's a sure I know who you're talking about, but not really. But now I do.
All right, ladies, thank you so much. Now, tomorrow you're going to be on Jody McBrayer, Backline with Jody McBrayer.
Yes.
And Jody is a four-time nominated, Grammy-nominated singer from Avalon, the Christian group. You guys are going to have a great time.
Great.
And then I think you might be
next
on his
week.
Yes. So, and then I'm sure eventually
I'm going to get you on the Marlon Dave show. And you know what we're going to do?
What?
We're going to write a song.
Well,
and
right.
I'm going to trap you and the two of you and my husband Dave in a room. And then we're going to administer parts right on the spot. And finally, I'm going to get my everybody in Take Six has said that they were going
to
teach me to sing, and I'm still
talking. Come on, we can do it.
And they use me, too, to do background noise on albums. Like,
no,
I don't want to be a crowd noise anymore.
No, I'm already
a crowd noise expert.
Yes. Are you on that Christmas album? Are you on...
my daughter.
That's your baby?
The one, at the time, but which now my kids are 28, 25, and 22. That was my oldest daughter.
On the Night Before Christmas?
Yes.
I love it.
Uncle Vinny, tell us a story. That's my niece.
Sounds just like her.
Well, they used the kids because they didn't have to pay them. Sweat Lodge. That's what they did. They took our kids and used them without any money. We want our money for
same.
Our kids.
All right, we're out of here.
Thank
you guys so much. Stick
you
around.
So
we'll be right back on Ever Tony Sweet on Universal Broadcast.
Woohoo!
Thank you. to get things straight before I knock. Your friends, do you care what people say?